Hey guys, in this video we are going to take a look at protocol buffers, some of its advantages, how it fits into gRPC for a microservice architecture, and then we're going to create an example using Golang. And if you want to become a certified data scientist or data engineer with Python, check out DataCamp. There is a link in the description below this video. Protocol buffers, also known as Protobuf, is a method created by Google for serializing data. It's an extensible mechanism that is language neutral and platform neutral. It's useful in developing programs to communicate with each other over a wire or for storing data. Protobuf allows to define the required data structures using its IDL or interface definition language in files with the proto extension, and using those files as the source, we can generate code for multiple languages. Protobuf is used by default to define messages and services in gRPC. And if you don't know what gRPC is, in a nutshell, gRPC is a modern remote procedure call framework to connect applications using the HTTP2 protocol, and provides features such as authentication, bidirectional streaming, and flow control. This is an example of how protocol buffers fits into gRPC for microservices. In this example, we have a microservice architecture for a hotel booking system. In this case, the booking service, written in Golang, uses a gRPC stub as the client of two gRPC servers, payments and notifications. Both the request and response data structures, along with the client and server code, are generated using protocol buffers. The payments service is written in Java. The notifications service is written in Python. As we can see here, gRPC and Protobuf support a polyglot microservices architecture. Now let's see some of the advantages of using protocol buffers. With protocol buffers, data is binary and efficiently serialized. The data is fully typed. The data is compressed automatically. The data is serialized faster with less CPU usage than serializing into JSON or XML. The data schema can evolve over time without breaking deployed programs compiled using a previous version of the interface definition. Protobuf is being used in production by Google, Netflix, Square, CoreOS, and CockroachDB. And some tools that are similar to Protobuf are Apache Thrift, Apache Abro, MessagePack, and Microsoft Bond. Remember to subscribe to the channel, and let's get started. In order to be able to use protocol buffers, first we need to install ProtoC in our environment from this URL, and we can download a bundle that includes multiple languages, or we can download Protobuf and ProtoC just for the language that we're going to use. So here we have C++, C#, Java, and some others. I have installed ProtoC, so if I run it, we're gonna see that I can generate code for multiple languages like C++, C#, Java, JavaScript, but not for Golang. So in order to generate code in Golang, I need to install an additional library and I need to execute this. Go get and this URL, github.com/golang/protobuf/protoc-gen-go. Okay, let's run this. And now I will be able to generate code from the proto files to Golang. So let's create a proto file. So I'm going to call it person.proto. And first we need to specify the syntax that we're going to use. Syntax. And in this case, we're going to use proto 3. That is the latest version of the language. And we need to specify the package. And let's use main in this case. And we can specify messages. Protocol buffers is used basically to declare messages and services. So the messages are the data structures that are going to be part of the requests and responses between the applications or microservices. And then the services are going to be the interfaces between the systems. Let's say that I want to create a message to pass the information about a person. So I use the keyword message and then person. And here I can specify the attributes. So let's say that we have first name and we have a last name. And here I need to assign a number to each of these attributes. And if I execute protoc dash dash go underscore out, and I need to specify first the destination folder where I want to generate the Golang code and the source file. In this case, it's going to be person.proto. So if I run this, we're going to see that that Go file is generated and the package is going to be the same. And then it's going to generate a bunch of code, including an struct with the first name and the last name of the person. These are the attributes that we specified here. And here we have that are strings, and here specifies some details about the type for protobuf, for JSON, and also generates a bunch of functions and creates functions to unmarshal and marshal a person from and to byte arrays, creates merge function, size, and some other functions. And let's add some other attributes to this person. Let's say that we want to add the age of the person to this message. And let's say that we want to also specify the job of this person. So we define another message, we call it job. And here we can specify, for example, the title of the job. That is going to be a string. And let's say that we define the salary of the job. Float salary and the number of the attribute. And here we can say that a person has a job like this, and we specify the number of the attribute. It's going to be 4. And let's say that we want to specify a list of friends of this person. We can use the keyword repeated for that, repeated. And we include the type of that list. That's going to be person, and we say friends. This is the name of the attribute, and we specify the number of the attribute, but it's going to be 5 in this case. So if we run again this command, and if we go to the Golang code, we're going to see that we have the job struct included the title and the salary. That is the message that we specified here. And we also gonna see here the person struct with the first name, the last name, the age that we specified, the job, that is this one. And we see a person slice, and that's the way that protobuf generates this line. Okay, I'm going to close this, and I'm going to remove all these attributes. And I'm going to keep just this message to keep it simple, and I'm going to regenerate the Golang code again, and here we just have the person struct with the first name, last name, and the rest of the code that is generated by protobuf. Okay, let's go back, let's close this, and now I'm going to create a main file where I'm going to use that person struct, this one, and I'm going to use protobuf to serialize an instance of that struct. So it's going to be package main. I'm going to create a main function, and I'm going to create a person, person and I'm going to pass the first name. Going to be Sean, and the last name that is going to be Doe. Okay, and now I'm going to use the proto library to marshal this person, basically to serialize this person. Proto dot marshal, and I'm going to pass the person. And here I need to import this is github.com/golang/protobuf/proto. I'm going to receive either a byte array or an error. So it's going to be serialized person error. And here I need to handle the error. So if error is not nil, log.fuddle, and I'm going to specify a message, marshalling error, and I pass the error here. Okay, and now I'm going to create a file using this byte array. That is the serialized version of the person. So here I'm going to use ioutil dot write file, and I'm going to call this file person.data. I need to pass the serialized person, serialized person. And here I need to set the file mode. That's going to be 0644. Okay, I'm going to run this. And here we have our binary file. And here I added the serialized version using XML and JSON for the same data. Here's the XML version, and here is the JSON version of serializing an instance of that struct. And if we run stat, that will retrieve the size of these files. We can see, for example, person.xml. Here we see the size is 70. And if we check person.json, the size is 40. But if we check the file that we serialize using protocol buffers, it's a lot less, it's 11. So that is one of the main advantages of using protocol buffers. The data is binary and is compressed automatically. So we can see the difference between using this binary format and using JSON or XML. Okay, now let's go back to the main file, and I'm going to convert that serialized person, this variable actually, back into a struct instance by using the unmarshal function of the protocol buffers library for Golang. So I'm going to use this serialized person variable here, that is a byte array, and I'm going to unmarshal that variable using this new struct, this new variable here, person2. Here I'm handling the error, and here I'm going to print the two attributes of that struct. And here we get the first name and the last name that we defined here. That's all I have for today. Thank you for watching, and I see you guys in the next one. Take care. Bye.